ولقد نعلم أنك يضيق صدرك بما يقولون فسبح بحمد ربك وكن من الساجدين واعبد ربك حتى يأتيك اليقين. أما بعد، معشر المؤمنين، in the past few weeks, some ayat in the Quran that most of us only read have been demonstrated in real life. But the condition of the Muslims should not be a reactive and a lagging one. It always should be ahead of the event. In the many Jumu'ahs, in the many years that have lapsed, mention was made from the sources of our conviction and our commitment from the Quran and the Sunnah regarding those who harbor and who generate and who express and then who put in life and death issues their positions of animosity and enmity and war against those who are committed to Allah. But a khutbah here and there is not going to cut the ice regarding those who are well entrenched behind their militaries, their economies, their diplomatic corps, their intelligence agents, their army bases, and the rest of these positions that they are in when it comes to our presence in this world. What value is there in Muslims who for the past not weeks and months but years and decades if not centuries have been attuned and conditioned to understand Islam as a matter of ritual only and not as a matter of a force to be reckoned with in life and in existence? What do you say to a Muslim public that has been fed throughout the past year with a constant stifle of litany about the rituals of Islam, and now all of a sudden the Muslim public has to contend with forces that want to kill its will, who want to kill its future, kill its children, and kill its resolve. When we look back at the previous when we look back at Islamic conferences, we find that there is a vacuum because people, Muslims, are not prepared for the type of issue that we have to deal with now. Where today, this Friday, and just in the past few Fridays, all of a sudden, imams and khatibs and preachers and those who are delivering sermons are speaking about jihad. And they're speaking about using the oil weapons. And they are speaking about those who are in charge of our own affairs. We're going to meet tomorrow in a summit meeting in Cairo, kings and presidents in Arab countries. But the Muslim public is not able to absorb this in an Islamic reference because throughout all of these years, no one is building for this Muslim public an Islamic spirit and the environment and renew the Muslims into it. Without us being armed with the necessary knowledge that comes to us from Allah and comes to us from His Prophet, that comes to us from the ayat that speak the fact that we are witnessing and the experience of the Prophet who had to deal with these same types of people. Tomorrow is going to be a summit meeting in Congress. Kings and presidents and rulers from Morocco to Iraq are going to gather in Egypt. To do what? You would think that they would gather to try to help when a portion of the Muslims are under attack, namely the Muslims in the Holy Land. And when Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa now is under siege. Last week, the Yahudi security forces would not permit anyone who is 45 years or younger from going into Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and having their Jumu'ah prayers in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. This week, they are saying they will not permit anyone who is below 40 years of age to go into Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and pray Salat and offer Salat al-Jumu'ah there. This is a virtual confiscation of the Muslims' first Qibla and their first Haram. Who is to tell Muslims they cannot know and pray in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa? And now we have Yahud physically with their military forces placing a cordon around the Masjid Al-Aqsa and saying to Muslims, you cannot come and pray in this Masjid. And tomorrow these heads of state are going to meet in Cairo. And these heads of state, in as far as the Muslim public is concerned, are not developed in light of the Quran and the Sunnah. Does the Muslim public understand that these heads of state who pray five times a day and offer their Islamic rituals, or the majority of them offer their Islamic rituals as they are expected to, but does the Muslim public place them in the same category of those who are opening up fire and killing Muslims in the Holy Land? The hard answer to that is no. The Muslim public has not matured to the degree where they can equate these types of rulers with their counterparts in Tel Aviv. Where the ayat of the Quran have been missing throughout all of these khutbahs, all of these years, to explain to the Muslim public who they are dealing with. And so, when Muslim khatibs, preachers, and imams, when they ascend the minbar on Friday, and all of a sudden now they are talking about using the economic weapon, the oil weapon, to stop the flow of oil to the West, they do so in a vacuum that is not sustained with the proper body of information that is extracted from the Quran and from the Sunnah. And then we have those officials from Saudi Arabia and Kuwait on television yesterday and this past week, saying in effect that no one should be told. The economic oil element into this political and military syrup in Palestine. And they want to get away with that. Why? Because they have the relative naivete of the Muslim public at work, and that ignorance in the Muslim public was fueled and fed by people from the minbar in all of these past years. If there were people speaking from the minbar the word of Allah and the word of the Prophet without any red lines, without any conditions, without any restrictions on their minds and their expressions, then now at a time like this, when they are stirring trouble in our holy land, we will have the appropriate and the necessary and the accurate information to place these events in context. But as far as we are concerned, even though we may not be speaking to a general Muslim public, but to those who can hear our words, we say, these people who belong to Arab Arabian establishment, they speak the words of hypocrisy, and they lie to the public. They say they do not want to use the oil weapon because it will be premature to use it now, because they tell us the circumstances are not right to use the oil weapon. When Muslims are being killed, and when there is a grand, there's reason to believe that there is a grand plan to dislocate hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of Muslims from the Holy Land and redraw the map in the area, that these don't constitute, in their opinion, the right circumstances to use the oil weapon, as if they are in control of oil. To begin with, the oil doesn't belong to them. The oil belongs to their masters and sponsors and protectors. But the Muslim public is not anchored in the certitude of this fact. You come to the Muslim public and you say, yes, the oil that's produced by Saudi Arabia is Saudi Arabia's oil. Or by Kuwait, it is Kuwait's oil. Etc., etc. No! It doesn't belong to them. It belongs to the people who they say they share interests with. They say that there is a world of common and shared interests. So the United States and Saudi Arabia share interests. So this oil is a shared commodity, as is, or are, political decisions that are made that become shared commodities. If that is true, and if they don't want, if the conditions are not right to use the oil weapon, we remind them, our memories are not short. We remind them only 15, not even that, 14 years ago, in 1986, why were they using the oil as an instrument of war? At that time, Iraq had launched aggression against the Islamic State in Iran. And then these same sources of oil and petroleum began to flood the market with oil. And the price at one point of a barrel of oil during those days was as low as $6 to $7 per barrel. Why was it permissible for them to use the oil weapon at that time? When this was a war that in their own heads was won upon Muslims. But now that there is a beginning of a war against the common enemy that everyone agrees upon, they are not willing to use this weapon in their hands. Their revenue from this oil, when the prices are $30 to $40 a barrel in Saudi Arabia, their revenue goes up. They tell us these are their words and these are their numbers. It's around $113 billion a year. But when the price drastically is reduced, their revenue also is drastically reduced. And from $113 billion, it goes down to $11 billion. These are their own words. These are their own figures. And now, when it comes time to use whatever resources we have for the sake of our brothers and sisters, children, now, in the past 3 weeks, 22 days, since the outbreak of this intifada, there has been around 135 victims, Palestinians, who have been killed. More than a third of them, more than 40 of them, have been children. There has been over 3,000 who have been maimed or injured. And the majority of them are children. All of this is unfolding in front of the eyes and the ears of the officials in the countries around. And what do they say? What do they want to do? They want to hold a summit meeting tomorrow to discuss what? They want to assail and they want to repudiate the Israeli position. Or if they want to do something, they want to recall or withdraw their representatives, whether they are commercial representatives or whether they are diplomatic representatives from occupied Palestine. And they want to tell those who are representing the diplomatic or the trade interests of Yehudi Israel to leave certain places like Morocco and Tunisia and Oman and Qatar. But why isn't anyone speaking about withdrawing or expelling for once and for all the Israeli ambassadors from Egypt and from Jordan? Why haven't there been permission given to the Muslims to demonstrate their anger and their rage in front of these diplomatic missions in Muslim land? There hasn't been, in the past 3 weeks, but this bloodshed and mayhem in the Holy Land, there hasn't been one demonstration in front of the Israeli Zionist Yehudi diplomatic mission in Cairo or in Amman. And still, they were to put there yesterday a representative of the Gulf oil-producing countries. Kuwait, Emirates, Qatar, Oman, Saudi Arabia, and Bahrain. The Saudi who represents these oil-producing countries said that the price of oil should be free. Imagine, in the circumstances that we are in, and we said previously that it is too much for them to listen to someone who is advising them to cut off oil, at least decrease the flow of oil. If they are exporting 6 million barrels of oil a day in Saudi Arabia, what's wrong with exporting 3 million barrels of oil a day? Or 3.5 million? That's not cutting it off. And the same is applicable to other oil producers. No, we should export more oil to bring down the price of oil from $28 to $30 a barrel, or a little more than $30 a barrel, to $24 and $23 a barrel. In these circumstances, they have the courage to stand in front of a public and telling us, this is what we want to do. In other words, what are you willing to do? They expressed their mind. They said what they are planning on doing. And the Yahoos on the other side, they can open fire and kill us today. Just before coming to Jumu'ah prayers, the latest news was there were 9 shaheeds who were killed in one of the most ferocious exchanges of fire in the past 3 weeks. There were, last count, 279 who were injured and maimed and incapacitated in these exchanges of fire. And all of this is on the Muslim side. Yahud are using helicopter gunships, automatic weapons, machine guns, tanks. They are using whatever they can against individuals who are throwing stones. And what does the Western media tell us? They say there's been about 105 casualties in the past 3 weeks, and most of them are Palestinians. Listen to the way they express themselves. 105, they say, and that's not accurate because there's 135. But then they say, most of them are Palestinians. What a nice and convenient way to buffer the aggression of these Yahoos, whose nature is to kill the flesh and blood representation of what is good, from prophets to Palestinians. That's their history. And now we have apologetic rulers who are acting as a defense system. These governments in Arab countries are a defense system. What else? Why now isn't there a public declaration and accessibility to the front lines in occupied Palestine? There should be hundreds, if not millions, of Muslims now on their way to the occupied land. From all directions, what are they going to do? They want to kill Muslims from around the world and antagonize almost 1.5 billion Muslims and their families in the world. If they want to do that, we will have redefined the parameters of this conflict and confrontation and taken it out of a simple Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But those kings and presidents in Arabian lands. They don't want to do that. Because they will begin to lose their thrones and their palaces. They want us to shiver down. Some representatives of a broad line of political parties met in Beirut this past week. And they declared that tomorrow, when these Arab heads of state, Arabian heads of state are meeting in Cairo, that everyone should not go to work. Life should come to a standstill tomorrow. From the Atlantic Ocean to the Persian Gulf. Is that enough? Should that be the only response? Or should we begin to think as we are expected to? Should there be any more questions regarding the nature of this Israeli malignancy in the Muslim body? Does anyone still harbor or think for a moment that there is room for reconciliation with these Yahud? Can any Muslim in his right mind and heart find a common ground with these racist, bloodthirsty enemies of Allah? And then they have here in the United States, they have demonstrations not only in the United States, but in other Western countries. There are many demonstrations in the major cities against the Israeli government. And here in this country, most of the talk that we know of at these demonstrations are channeled into the election season. Many of these speakers at these rallies and marches are telling Muslims, now you should be careful for whom you are going to vote. And once again, they prey on the ignorance in the public mind. They take advantage of years upon years of a ritualistic Islam that has been pumped into the Muslim mind. Why? Why are we supposed to be careful for whom we are going to vote when we are not told by the prime candidate for the highest office in the land what their position would be on this Islamic issue? Has anyone extracted a statement from any of these leaders or potential leaders on what they will do for these people who are exposed to Israeli savagery and the killing machine of the Zionists in the Holy Territory? None of them were capable. None of them were on record for saying what they would do for the Muslims. So what hope are we supposed to be anxious about or against? And then, on one of these occasions, this speaker was invited to speak. And then, after a few minutes, they said, you would have to terminate your presentation. Why? Because this speaker was telling the public that this issue, even though there are some people who think that it should be solved through diplomatic effort and political channels, but this is not a time for us to disagree when we have a common enemy. Whether we are Christians or Muslims, whether we believe in the diplomatic approach or whether we believe in the military approach, this is no time to try to open up an internal hemorrhage. But those Muslims who believe in a military solution, those people who have seen the light, they have all the right in the world to familiarize themselves with bearing arms. If we are serious about these events, we would not demonstrate in the streets, and only demonstrate in the streets. We would also be going out and practicing how we should be able to carry a gun and to use a gun. And when Muslims do it, they will do it in the appropriate moral context. Isn't it our right to defend ourselves? Isn't it our right to regain what is ours? Isn't it our right to repossess what is rightfully in our land? So why do people get upset with that? If we were strictly to speak in the American context, away from Islamic terminology, we would say that Charlton Heston has more testosterone than many of these Muslims who are protesting. The Second Amendment of the Constitution of the United States guarantees everyone the right to bear arms and to use arms. But when it comes to Muslims, oh no, you can't do that. Muslims will tell you that before anyone else. Don't even think about it. Why? I want to be just like everyone else. If the law guarantees it for so-and-so, it guarantees it for me. Why? Am I less in the course of law than anyone else? Because the Muslims, are the victims. And if we can't say this at times like this, when can we ever be able to say it? But as you heard, it was look. To go to these people who are taking polls. There's a poll this past week about how Muslims are going to vote in the United States. They're telling us, according to this one poll, that 40% of the Muslims are going to vote for Bush, and 26% or so are going to vote for Gore, and there's another 24% or so who are undecided or going to vote for the others. Meaning Nader or Buchanan or others. But has there been a poll? Even these polls are controlled. Has there been a poll that went to Muslims and said, in times like this, would you want to bear arms and you know how to use arms to protect yourself? Do you have confidence in governments protecting you? Or do you think at the end of the day you are going to have to protect yourself? Why don't they go around with polls like these in the United States? Because the questions and the polls themselves are conditioned and calibrated. People are not supposed to think in a direction that will free them. And we Muslims have many incentives to think in the direction that will free us, especially at times like this. If Muslims continue to think that these governments, look at these military, look at all of this, the money they spend. They tell you Israel spends every year around $7 billion for its armed forces. That's what it calls its defense budget. And these three heads of state who are going to meet in Cairo tomorrow, not only they look at Israel, they look at Iran. They say Iran is spending, these are their words, between $6 and $7 billion every year on their defense program. What are you spending? You can tell us how much you are spending on your defense program. And whether you have a military industry to speak about. When you were threatened 10 years ago, you ran all around the world for protection. You came to Washington, you went to London and France, and you signed on the dotted line for tens of billions of dollars of weapons to which you will ultimately depend on the military-industrial complex of the Yahud and the Kafirin and the Mushrikeen, and you don't have simple factories to manufacture simple arms for the basic rights that you are supposed to defend, your human rights, your civil rights, and your natural rights. None of that. And how much are you spending? Does anyone know how much Saudi Arabia, the contract that it signed with the Pentagon, and in Europe, and around the world, and at times like this, they're not thinking about using it. At times like this, they're not even thinking about using a very passive issue. A very simple issue, and that is to turn to the side of their own people. There were no demonstrations in Saudi Arabia for the Palestinians. Only one demonstration was recorded in a town that is near the Jordanian border. In Riyadh, there were some Muslim sisters who tried to march in the street. And according to some news reports, these Muslim sisters were not permitted to express their solidarity with the mothers and the sisters in the occupied land. What are they good for? And then we have some Muslims who go and then pray with them. They place their bodies in the front row of Saudi-sponsored masjids and jumu'ahs and umrahs and hajjis. And they don't turn around and ask these people, what are you doing? Are we Muslims? When we speak about the Brotherhood of Islam, this is the time in which we understand who our brothers are. Are there any brothers around? It's a cheap word. A Muslim, an African-American Muslim, a non-Arab Muslim, goes to these sites and says, yeah, listen to what you're saying. Do you mean what you are saying? Is he your brother? Is he, ya akhi, like you are speaking to him? Most of their money are overseas. One report says there are 56,000 millionaires in the United Arab Emirates. At a time now when the population in Palestine is under siege, they're barely finding anything, they're running out of supplies to eat. And there's 56,000 millionaires in one of these states in the Arabian Peninsula and Gulf. And then you come and say, yeah, Akhi, think before you speak. We don't want to react. We want to understand for these killers of Muslims are. There are active killers that are pulling the trigger, and there are passive killers who are supporting those who are pulling the trigger. We want to understand the gamut, the spectrum of this animosity. We don't want to react to it. We want to have a sustained confrontation with it. It will take another generation, another century, it doesn't matter. Once our information is traced, it is contacted. ولتجدنهم أحرص الناس على حياة. قل يا تستخفون منه فإنه ملاقيكم، ثم تردون إلى عالم الغيب والشهادة فينبئكم بما كنتم تعملون. لعن الذين كفروا من بني إسرائيل على لسان داود وعيسى ابن مريم، ذلك بما عصوا وكانوا يعتدون، كانوا لا يتناهون عن منكر فعلوه، لبئس ما كانوا يفعلون. وجعل منهم القردة والخنازير وعبد الطاغوت، وقالوا يد الله مغلولة غلت أيديهم ولعنوا بما قالوا، وقالوا لن تمكن النار إلا أياما معدودات. قل اتخذتم عند الله عهدا، قل فلم يعذبكم الله بذنوبكم، بل انتم بشر ممن خلق. وقالوا نحن ابناء الله واحباؤه. قال في الايات انني من هو ايات القران. Are not to be given in times of crises, are not to be delivered under siege. These are ayats that should flow freely in the Muslim mind, so that we all take the necessary steps and bear the necessary responsibility to eradicate these Yahud from our presence. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وأدعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة وتوبوا إلى الله إن الله هو التواب الرحيم. ولله بجميع المحامد على جميع المحامد، صلى الله وسلم على المبعوث خيرا ورحمة وهدى لكافة الأمم محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, there is a fact that we should all identify and begin to deal with as Allah and His Prophet expect us to. And that fact is that the deniers of Allah, of Bani Israel, they are at a time in which they feel and think that they are in control of the affairs that pertain to their deified Israel. They have a new God. Their God is Israel. They kill for Israel. They spy for Israel. They lie for Israel. They do everything that violates the words and the commandments of God for Israel. And they have garnered and harnessed formidable economic military and political leverage in the world. And we are not simpletons. The economic and political and military combination of influence that they have on a world scale has been depopulating Iraq for the past decade. And the Muslims in the occupied land have become a demographic problem to these same people. And one of the solutions that they have come up with is to transfer the Palestinian population away from Palestine. And with the instability that they seek to deploy for their national God and deity, Israel, it is not far-fetched to say that this is a program they may want to execute in the coming weeks. And the official establishments around will not help the Muslim or Palestinian people. They will help the Yehudi and the Israeli government in executing this plan. Within all of this, the unknown as far as they are concerned is the Islamic determination and the Islamic program that they are not privy to. And from this Islamic program, from this Islamic determination, they have only tasted the beginning of it. They saw what happened to them in southern Lebanon. And they will see from the same quarters, from the same sources, what will happen to them in other areas in their own territory. Come these weeks and these months in the future. We are not on our way out. They can continue to fool the previous generations and the elite who are ruling in the Arabian land. But they're not going to continue to fool the dedicated and the committed Muslims who draw inspiration from Allah's Prophet and who draw support and security from Allah Himself. We look forward to only two results. Exquisite results. It's either a shahada or a triumph and victory. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah. Wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabah. ولا تجعلهم ملتبسا علينا واجعلنا للمتقين اماما اللهم اليك نشكو ضعف قوتنا وقله حيلتنا وحولنا على الناس يا ارحم الراحمين انت ربنا وانت رب المستضعفين فإلى من تكلنا إلى غريب يتجهمنا أم إلى عدو ملكته أمرنا إن لم يكن بك علينا غضب فلا نبالي ولكن عافيتك هي أوسع لنا نعوذ بنور وجهك الذي أشرقت له الظلمات وصلح عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة من أن تنزل بنا غضبك أو تحل علينا سخطك لك العتبى حتى ترضى ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك اللهم بك نحاول وبك نحاول وبك نقاتل. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا صل على محمد وآل محمد. ربنا بارك على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم وباركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر في اسمه وسعى في خرابها أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين. لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل إن الله نعيما يعظكم به إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون يعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. بعد الصلاة
وَلَكُمُ السَّلَامَ وَلَكُمُ السَّلَامَ الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله. أقيموا أتدينوا إنساء وصفوفكم سلينة السيوة فالصفوف من إكرام الصلاة. Straight lines please. Shoulder to shoulder and heart to heart.
الله أكبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا صراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين وآتى المال على حبه ذوي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل والسائلين وفي الرقاب وأقام الصلاة وآتى الزكاة والموفون بعهدهم إذا عاهدوا والصابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس
أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك هم المتقون. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
Thank you. Thank you.